Okay. Welcome, everyone, to the Institute for Critical Study of Society, also known by its acronym ICSS, well known by now for its Sunday morning program at the Niebel Proctor Marxist Library. Good morning to people on the Pacific Coast, and good day and good evening to those joining east of us here. My name is Raj Sahai. ICSS was formed at this location, Niebel Proctor Marxist Library, in 2004 to preserve Marx's heritage and to support struggles for social justice and a struggle for socialism leading to communism. We are meeting here again today for the first time after 28 months due to the ongoing COVID pandemic. So those present here, please keep your mask on and maintain a physical distance of 6 feet from others as far as possible. Today's session is a hybrid session. As many people are joining us through the internet, we hope this first session, hybrid session, will be a smooth one. The opinion expressed in our forum are only of its authors, but we are all united in our respect for the work of Karl Marx, who in his 11th thesis on Feuerbach said, "The philosophers have interpreted the world in different ways. The point, however, is to change it." Our speaker today is a researcher, historian, and author, Professor Grover Furr of Montclair State University in New Jersey. His talk today is based on his research that produced his new book titled The Fraud of the Testament of Lenin. Testament of Lenin is within quotes, on which he will speak today. Before I hand the floor to him, let me give you some background. It is hard for me to put down his books. I can tell you that once I start reading them. This one is no exception, although I have not finished reading it. There are two reasons for it. Number one is my intense interest in this period of the history of the USSR, that is 1917 to 89. And number two, because Professor Furr's methodology is like that of the famous fictional investigator Sherlock Holmes. He's interested in truth and not be siding with any side. But unlike the fictional characters of Sherlock Holmes and his buddy, Dr. Watson, the characters in this book are real, and the consequences of their actions profound for the future of humanity. The immediate persons of interest in this historical drama are three, mainly three: Stalin, Krupskaya, Lenin's wife, and once again, the most controversial actor of the Russian Revolution, Leon Trotsky. Trotsky is an iconic figure of Russian Revolution, a courageous revolutionary, a prolific writer, and a reasonably competent commissar of war during the Russian Civil War, but very ambitious and an ego as big as the Himalayan mountains. He considered himself to be an equal of Lenin, but his ideology was that of a non-Bolshevik. He was, in Lenin's assessment, a revolutionary Menshevik, but one who played a significant role in the revolution. After Lenin's death in January 1924, Trotsky published his collected works and tried to put his own thesis as the continuation of Leninism. An intense public debate followed for more than a year, in which Stalin strongly defended off this attempt and defended Leninism. Trotsky was politically defeated in 1926, but he did not give up. He was externally exiled in 1929 to Turkey. Trotskyism also survived in the USSR, in fact, survives all over the world in some measure, mostly in the intelligentsia in the USSR, though formally they had given it up and they were still a part of the ruling USSR Communist Party until 1930s. Professor Furr has written three books on Trotsky's various attempts to depose Stalin and his followers and take power through a combination of German conquest and internal revolt by his supporters in the Russian Communist Party against Stalin-led government. But that was a decade later, in 1930s. In the present book, Professor Furr analyzes the so-called Lenin's Testament, which appeared a few months before Lenin was totally incapacitated on March 10, 1934 by a massive stroke. So who were the actors behind this so-called Lenin's testament ascribed to Lenin? This, in fact, was the first attempt to remove Stalin from his position of general secretary, as far as I can determine, to which he was nominated by none other than Lenin himself just 8 months earlier. A few copies of his new books are available here for purchase. We also have a copy of each one of his prior books. Please join me in welcoming Professor Grover Furr to the ICSS Sunday morning.
Raj, you need to turn on the microphone one.
Yes, sorry. Yeah, it's on.
Okay, I'm just changing my glasses here.
Yeah.
So how is this? Is this good? The sound 17. Okay? Sound is okay? Okay.
17.
Good. Excellent. I'm gonna read my talk for purposes of better organization and so forth. So I won't be able to look at the audience directly in the eye. I hope you forgive me. I'd like to begin with this short preface. Persons who are or were in or around the old left are usually more or less familiar with the allegations of crimes leveled against Joseph Stalin by anti-communists and Trotskyists. My talk today is directed mainly to you. Persons who do not belong to this group, mainly perhaps younger people, may have heard that Stalin is considered a bad guy and accused of many crimes, but they probably don't remember much more than that. If this sounds like you out there, or persons that you know, I recommend my book, Stalin Waiting for the Truth. That book discusses virtually all of the alleged crimes of Stalin of the 1930s and shows with evidence how they are lies. What is Lenin's testament? Here is a summary by super anti-communist Harvard professor, the late Richard Pipes. Quote, in 1922, Lenin suffered two massive strokes that gradually eliminated him from public activity. Though disabled, he watched with growing dismay Stalin's high-handed behavior and began to wonder whether he had not made a mistake, endowing him with such great powers. In December 1922 and January 1923, he, Lenin, dictated a document that came to be known as his testament. In it, he wrote as follows. Here's another quote. Stalin is too rude, and this shortcoming, fully tolerable within our midst and in our relations as communists, becomes intolerable in the post of general secretary. For this reason, I suggest that the comrades consider how to transfer Stalin from this post and replace him with someone who, in all other respects, enjoys over comrade Stalin only one advantage, namely greater patience, greater loyalty, greater courtesy, and attentiveness to comrades, less capriciousness, etc. End quote. End quote of Lenin. This powerful denunciation of Stalin, first published in the New York Times in 1926, as translated by Max Eastman, had to wait 30 years before it became public knowledge in the Soviet Union, following Khrushchev's denunciation of Stalin at the 20th Party Congress. Subsequently, it was included in the fifth edition of Lenin's collected works. Now that's end quotation by Pipes. In a discussion that Pipes doesn't mention, Lenin supposedly wrote, quote, "Comrade Stalin, having become Secretary General, has unlimited authority concentrated in his hands, and I am not sure whether he will always be capable of using that authority with sufficient caution. Comrade Trotsky, on the other hand, as his struggle against the Central Committee on the question of the People's Commissariat of Communications has already proved, is distinguished not only by outstanding ability, he is personally perhaps the most capable man in the present Central Committee." End quote. Pipes continues, quote, "Another incident occurred that further alienated Lenin from Stalin. Lenin congratulated Trotsky for having won a battle over foreign trade. Stalin promptly learned of this communication. He telephoned Nadezhda Krupskaya, Lenin's wife, rudely criticized her for informing Lenin about party and state affairs in violation of the rules he had established, and threatened her with an investigation. Having hung up the phone, Krupskaya became hysterical, sobbing and rolling on the floor. When he learned of this incident several months later, Lenin sent Stalin the following note. Quote, Lenin, respected comrade Stalin, you had the rudeness to telephone my wife and abuse her. Although she had told you of her willingness to forget what you had said, I have no intention of forgetting so easily what is done against me. And needless to say, I consider whatever is done to my wife to be directed also against myself. For this reason, I request you to inform me whether you agree to retract what you have said and apologize, or prefer a breach of relations between us. End Lenin quote. These are the most important of the quotations from the documents known as Lenin's Testament, documents that are sharply critical about Stalin. Like all Western anti-communist and Trotskyist writers, Pipes firmly believed that these attacks by Lenin on Stalin were genuine. All that is except Princeton professor and Hoover Institution fellow Stephen Kotkin. In volume one of his projected three-volume biography of Stalin, published in 2014, Kotkin decisively rejected the genuineness of the Testament of Lenin. This confused Pipes, and Pipes wrote, quote, it comes as a considerable surprise to have Kotkin reject the Testament as very likely a fabrication. He refers to it as a document attributed to Lenin, whose authenticity has never been proven. Although Kotkin acknowledges that it could be authentic, he does not clearly accept it as such, as it has been by all other historians. As noted, it is included in Lenin's collected works. End quote. Pipes does not inform his readers that Kotkin took this view of Lenin's testament from Russian scholar Valentin A. Sakharov. The English language Wikipedia page on Lenin's testament also dismissed Kotkin's rejection of the testament with these words, quote Wikipedia. Historian Stephen Kotkin argued that the evidence for Lenin's authorship of the testament is weak and suggested that the testament could have been created by Krupskaya. However, the testament has been accepted as genuine by other historians, including E.H. Carr, Isaac Deutscher, Dmitry Volkogonov, Vadim Rogovin, and Oleg Klyevnyuk, and Kotkin's argument was specifically rejected by Richard Pipes. End Wikipedia quote. This passage from Wikipedia bears the earmarks of Trotskyism. No one else ever cites Trotskyist historians Isaac Deutscher and Vadim Rogovin, while Russian historian Oleg Klyevnyuk, the other, scare quotes, world expert on Stalin, in scare quotes, is the Trotskyist counter to Kotkin because, in addition to rejecting the testament's validity, Kotkin also states, truthfully, that Lenin had little use for Trotsky. The Russian language Wikipedia page article on Lenin's testament is more honest. It states, quote, a number of modern Russian historians, V.A. Sakharov, U.N. Zhukov, V.P. Ivanov, V.K. Yermakov, expressed doubts about the authorship of Lenin, assuming that Krupskaya or Trotsky could have been the true author of the letter. End quote. Pipes did not bother to check Kotkin's footnotes to see that Kotkin's rejection of the testament's validity reflects his agreement with Sakharov's research that also inspired my book, The Fraud of the Testament of Lenin, this book here. The document known as Lenin's Testament was first revealed to the world in a front page article in the New York Times on October 18, 1926, under this headline, quote, Lenin Testament at last revealed. Letter hidden after leader's death, warned against Stalin and extolled Trotsky. Max Eastman has text, end quote. These documents came to light gradually during 1923. They all came from Lenin's secretariat and were revealed by Lenin's wife, Nadezhda Konstantinovna Krupskaya. Eastman later revealed that he had obtained these texts indirectly from Krupskaya. This reflects Krupskaya's support at that time for the anti-Stalin opposition. In 1922 and 23, Lenin suffered a number of strokes. After mid-December 1922, he was no longer able to write. All Lenin documents after that date were dictated, or supposedly dictated. None of them bear Lenin's signature or even his initials. All of the documents known as Lenin's testament came to light only after Lenin had suffered, on the night of March 9th to 10th, 1923, a final stroke that deprived him of the ability to speak. In 1963, one of his secretaries, Maria Voloditcheva, told an interviewer, quote, "It became officially known that on March 6th, or even on March 5th, Vladimir Ilyich was unable to read, work, receive anyone, or do anything," end quote. This is important because Lenin supposedly dictated several crucial documents of his testament on these days, March 5th, 6th, and 7th, 1923. At the 13th and 14th Party Congresses in 1924 and 1925, the political opposition within the Bolshevik Party, whose main leader was Trotsky, but which also included Bukharin, Zinoviev, Kamenev, and at this time, Krupskaya, tried to use these documents against Stalin. They were not successful. The delegates approved of Stalin's work in the Secretariat. The testament documents were published in 1924. They were not published again in the Soviet Union until Khrushchev did so in 1956. In his famous secret speech to the 20th Party Congress of the Communist Party of the Soviet Union on February 25th, 1956, Nikita Khrushchev read from the part of Lenin's testament that is particularly critical of Stalin. Here is some of what Khrushchev said about the testament. Quote, this is Khrushchev. "In addition to the great accomplishments of V.I. Lenin, his acute mind expressed himself also in this, that he detected in Stalin, in time, those negative characteristics which resulted later in grave consequences. Fearing the future fate of the party and of the Soviet nation, Lenin made a completely correct characterization of Stalin, pointing out that it was necessary to consider the question of transferring Stalin from the position of the Secretary General because of the fact that Stalin is excessively rude, that he does not have a proper attitude towards his comrades, that he is capricious and abuses his power. These negative characteristics of his developed steadily, and during the last years acquired an absolutely insufferable character," end Khrushchev quote. Khrushchev's secret speech had an enormous worldwide impact. In it, Khrushchev basically said that the Soviet Union and the international communist movement had been led for the previous 30 years by a homicidal tyrant. This is just what the capitalists, Trotskyists, and other anti-communists wanted to hear. So they never questioned it. Why look a gift horse in the mouth? Trotsky claimed that Lenin had offered to form a bloc with him against Stalin, and that Lenin had wanted Trotsky to be his successor. But Stalin had cheated, murdered all Trotsky's supporters and anybody else he didn't trust, and led the Soviet Union to disaster. Trotskyists everywhere are firmly committed to claiming that Trotsky was Lenin's true successor, the real communist and true internationalist. Other people who claim the socialist label, like socialist humanists and social democrats, as well as anarchists, also eagerly embrace Khrushchev's claims of Stalin's supposed crimes, as do virtually all pro-capitalist anti-communists, including all certified academic experts on Soviet history. As I showed from primary source evidence in my first book, Khrushchev Lied, Khrushchev's allegations against Stalin are all provably, demonstrably false. The documents known as Lenin's Testament have played a foundational role in shaping the way millions of people view the history of the Soviet Union and the international communist movement during the period of Joseph Stalin's leadership. The so-called reforms initiated under Mikhail Gorbachev were called glasnost and perestroika. Glasnost, or openness, supposedly included a truthful account of Soviet history of the Stalin period. Perestroika meant market-oriented changes in the Soviet economy. Gorbachev and company promoted this as a, quote, return to Leninism, meaning the new economic policy of the 1920s. Within a few years, these so-called reforms led directly to the downfall of the Soviet Union, the dismantling of all the gains of socialism, and the return to predatory capitalism, with a catastrophic fall in the standard of living and life expectancy of all but a privileged few of the Soviet population. Alexander Yakovlev, first Gorbachev's head of propaganda and then a member of his Politburo, played an important and sinister role in spreading falsifications about Soviet history of the Stalin period. Here is what Yakovlev wrote about the secret campaign begun after Khrushchev's secret speech in 1956 to put an end to socialism. This is from Yakovlev's introduction to the Russian edition of the Black Book of Communism. It is not in the English version of that book. Quote, Yakovlev. After the 20th Congress, in an ultra narrow circle of our closest friends and associates, we often discussed the problems of democratization of the country and society. We chose a simple, like a sledgehammer, method of propagating the ideas of the late Lenin. A group of true, not imaginary, reformers developed, of course, orally only, the following plan: to strike with the authority of Lenin at Stalin, at Stalinism. And then, if successful, to strike with Plekhanov and social democracy at Lenin. And then, with liberalism and moral socialism, at revolutionism in general. The Soviet totalitarian regime could be destroyed only through glasnost and totalitarian party discipline while hiding behind the interests of improving socialism. Looking back, I can proudly say that this clever but very simple tactic worked. End Yakovlev quote. Yakovlev and others among the leadership of the Communist Party of the Soviet Union chose to use Lenin against Stalin as Khrushchev had done. The anti-Stalin texts of Lenin's testament were crucial in this anti-communist conspiracy. So the dispute over Lenin's testament, the use of Lenin to attack Stalin, is important for any understanding of the history of the Soviet Union and therefore of world history. My new book, The Fraud of the Testament of Lenin, once again, there's the cover, is largely based upon the research of Professor Valentin A. Sakharov of Moscow State University. Sakharov's 2003 book, Lenin's Political Testament, published by Moscow State University Press, is the result of years of study of archival documents of Lenin's works, drafts of those works, and originals of other important documents. It is in Russian and is 700 pages long. In my 2011 book, Khrushchev Lied, I cited Sakharov's research to indicate that it cast doubt on the genuine nature of the testament. After carefully rereading Kotkin's book, however, I decided that I needed to do a more thorough study of Sakharov's massive research. I also concluded that if I did not make the results of Sakharov's important research available in English, it might never be done by anyone. So in 2018, I decided to study Sakharov's book very closely. That study took me 3 years. It included translating long sections of the book into English, just to be certain that I understood Sakharov's argument accurately. I reached the same conclusion as did Sakharov, who had also convinced Kotkin, namely that Lenin's so-called testament is a fraud. In my book, I include chapters that examine the role in this fraud of Leon Trotsky and of Moshe Lewin's influential and pro-Trotsky 1967 book titled Lenin's Last Struggle. I also include a chapter on Krupskaya's part in this fraud. I make a number of references to Stephen Kotkin's book, Stalin, Paradoxes of Power, 1878 to 1928. This book does contain many passages attesting to Kotkin's anti-communism and to his willingness at times to abandon any pretense at objectivity. But Kotkin has studied Sakharov's book with great care. He summarizes Sakharov's discussion well. Kotkin accepts Sakharov's conclusion that the anti-Stalin documents in Lenin's last works, the so-called testament, are fabrications. However, Kotkin's remarks on the testament are scattered throughout his 900-page book. This makes his discussion of Sakharov's research inaccessible to any but the most dedicated reader. Sakharov divides Lenin's last writings into two groups: those that are unproblematically Lenin's work, and those that are attributed to Lenin but are of questionable authorship. In my book, I discuss this last group of documents. These are the ones called Lenin's Testament. Sakharov argues convincingly that all the documents in which Lenin supposedly criticized Stalin, expressed the wish to remove Stalin from the post of general secretary, and threatened to break off relations with Stalin, all these are fabrications. Like Sakharov, I too reached this conclusion through a detailed study of these and many other materials, including the journals of Lenin's secretaries and of the doctors on duty in Lenin's sick room. All the evidence points unequivocally to the conclusion that there never was any such thing as Lenin's testament. Lenin was not the author of those articles dated between December 1922 and March 1923 that are critical of Stalin. Nadezhda Krupskaya wrote those articles, probably with the help of other persons, including Trotsky. These documents are evidence of clandestine activity by prominent Bolsheviks, some of whom would later openly form opposition groups within the party. Later still, they would publicly renounce opposition, but continue secret conspiracies against Stalin and the Bolshevik leadership. At the time the false Lenin Testament documents were composed, this group included Krupskaya, Trotsky, and some of Trotsky's followers. As a professor at Moscow State University, Sakharov obtained privileged access to archival documents relating to the last years of Lenin's life, including the journals of Lenin's secretaries and documents from Lenin's secretariat. In some cases, he was permitted to make photographic copies of these documents, which I reproduce in an online appendix to my book. The originals are still classified in Russia today. Sakharov discovered that the fifth and final edition of Lenin's works, done in the 60s and 70s, lied about some of them and covered up others. These lies are reflected in the fourth and final English language edition of Lenin's works, which is over there in the bookshelf. In my new book, I discuss all the documents of the testament, plus related documents, in considerable detail. Here are a few examples. The secretary's journal was falsified. Large sections were set aside to be filled in later, long after the dates specified. Some were filled in later, and there are also many empty dates. In other words, the secretary simply did not keep a daily journal after December the 18th, 1922. This could not have happened unless Krupskaya, Lenin's wife, had agreed to it. She, not the secretaries, had authority over Lenin's secretariat. The doctor's journal was only published in 1991. It is more complete. In many instances, it contradicts the secretary's journal. The first set of documents in what is called Lenin's Testament, the letter to a Congress, exists in several versions with important differences. The first document, dated December 24th, 1922, was clearly written not to a Congress, but to an individual, almost certainly to Stalin. It was not related to the other parts of this supposed letter to a Congress. The other parts of the letter to a Congress are dated in a contradictory manner. The last two parts, including the edition of January 4th, 1923, which states that Stalin should be removed as general secretary, are analyzed carefully in my book. There is no evidence that Lenin dictated them. The essay on nationalism, this is Lenin's essay on nationalism, which contains sharp criticisms of Stalin, contradicts all of Lenin's previous and even recent views, and completely confuses the question of the formation of the Soviet Union on December 30th, 1922, a process in which Lenin was deeply involved. It cannot be by Lenin. Letters to Trotsky contradict the events that actually occurred. Most striking, perhaps, is the fact that Krupskaya deliberately lied when she claimed that Stalin criticized her on December 22, 1922. All other accounts of this event place it in late January or early February 1923. The so-called, quote, ultimatum letter, quote, by Lenin, dated March 7th, 1923, supposedly the last piece of writing he ever dictated, and in which he threatens to break off personal relations with Stalin, cannot be genuine. All these documents came out of Lenin's secretariat, over which Krupskaya presided. Krupskaya claimed that they were to be presented to the Party Congress after Lenin's death. But in fact, she presented them to individuals, several to Trotsky, long before Lenin died, but when he was paralyzed and unable to speak. In addition to a detailed study of the Lenin Testament documents and of Sakharov's analysis of them, I devote several additional chapters to the following: the Secretary's Journal, Trotsky's booklet on the Testament, and Moshe Lewin's 1968 book, Lenin's Last Struggle. In this book, Lewin elaborates the Khrushchev-era version of the Testament and endorses Trotsky's account, including Trotsky's own description of himself as Lenin's ally against Stalin and Lenin's designated successor. In each of these cases, careful study reveals that the official account, including Trotsky's self-serving version of events and Lewin's pro-Trotsky anti-Stalin version, contradicts the evidence now available. I devote a chapter to Krupskaya's role in the falsification of the Testament. It could not have been concocted without her active involvement. Lenin's secretaries Fotieva, Voledicheva, and Gliaser worked under her direct supervision. Trotsky may have been involved in some of the falsifications as well. Krupskaya was allied with him politically during this period. True to form, Trotsky falsified and lied about these last writings too. Two more chapters examine the memoirs of Lydia Fotieva, one of Lenin's secretaries, and two accounts of the Krupskaya-Stalin quarrel by Lenin's sister and constant companion, Maria Ilyinichna Ulyanova. It is clear that during the Khrushchev era, either Fotieva was coached by others or her memoir was ghostwritten by someone else. Interestingly, when she was interviewed after Khrushchev's ouster by journalist Alexander Beck, Fotieva defended Stalin, saying that they had all considered him to be a genius, second only to Lenin, and that she looked forward to a new edition of her memoir that would reflect a much more favorable view of Stalin. But that new version never appeared. In Maria Ilyinichna Ulyanova's first account of 1926, she utterly contradicts Krupskaya's account of this quarrel, and in fact blames Krupskaya and even Lenin himself for it. In a second account in 1929, Ulyanova gives a very contradictory version, both of Lenin's attitude towards Stalin and of the Krupskaya-Stalin quarrel, while still blaming Krupskaya. Both of her accounts emphasize that Stalin and Lenin were very close, that Lenin was closer to Stalin than to any other Soviet leader, and that Lenin never favored Trotsky. My book contains the first close reading and analysis of Ulyanova's puzzling and contradictory 1929 account. Sakharov has discovered that the Testament of Lenin is a fraud. The anti-Stalin and pro-Trotsky documents of the so-called Testament are forgeries. This is an important discovery. It is further evidence that Nikita Khrushchev's secret speech was nothing but lies. Khrushchev began his speech by quoting the Testament, as I pointed out. It removes Trotskyism's last support. We have long had evidence that Trotsky collaborated with the Germans and Japanese, with his supporters and homegrown fascists to sabotage the Soviet economy and to assassinate Soviet leaders. We have long known that Trotsky lied deliberately many, many times. In earlier books, I have thoroughly discussed the primary source evidence that proved that Trotsky lied. I have shown that we do not even need documents from former Soviet archives to prove that Trotsky lied. That can be proven from Trotsky's own writings. And now we know that Lenin did not attack Stalin and support Trotsky as the Testament states and as Trotsky always claimed. These discoveries should spell the end to the Trotsky cult. In the short run, the anti-Stalin paradigm will prevent these facts from being widely circulated. Persons who are already firm Trotsky adherents will be unable to face the truth and will continue their adulation of their guru. But the younger generation, not harnessed to the disputes of the 20th century, will reject Trotskyism as a fraud that, thanks to support from pro-capitalist anti-communism, fooled too many people for too many years. This is all to the good. The Trotsky myth has long stood in the way of an objective understanding of the strengths and especially of the weaknesses of Soviet socialism, weaknesses that ultimately led to sabotage by its leaders and that we must study and understand. I would like to conclude my talk with some remarks about a question that may have been nagging you. Why do my books and articles about Soviet history of the Stalin period contradict all the official or mainstream, commonly accepted, or authoritative versions? At the start of this talk, I briefly quoted from some mainstream sources that conclude that Kotkin and Sakharov, and therefore I myself, must be wrong in saying that the testament of Lenin is a fabrication, that Lenin never wanted to get rid of Stalin, never called him too rude, never threatened to break off relations with him, and so on. When you heard that, some part of your brain may have whispered to you, but how could Sakharov, Kotkin, and Furr be right about Lenin's testament when all these other experts say they're wrong? A big part of the answer is anti-communism, here in the form of what I call the anti-Stalin paradigm. From 1918 until today, Soviet historiography has been falsified and distorted to fit the hostility of the capitalist class towards the idea that the working class, through a communist party, could take over a huge country and run it more successfully than the landowners and capitalists ever could. Before the Cold War, a few mainstream historians tried to be objective. One was E.H. Carr in his History of the Russian Revolution. Carr had been a British diplomat and had even drafted part of the Treaty of Versailles after World War I. But in the New York Times Book Review of December 30th, 1979, Richard Pipes called Carr, quote, a fairly orthodox Leninist, end quote, because in his book, The Russian Revolution from Lenin to Stalin, Carr had tried to be objective. Carr was simply insufficiently anti-communist to suit Pipes, who was a fervent Cold Warrior. Soviet historiography has not changed in any fundamental way since. It is still impossible to make a career as a historian of Russian and Soviet history unless you subscribe to the anti-Stalin paradigm. Stalin must be described as a mass murderer. Yakovlev says 15 million victims, about the average for this field. In reality, there is no evidence that Stalin committed any murders of anyone ever, much less mass murderers, or rather, the evidence is fake. Stalin must also be described as a dictator. Soviet history during the time Stalin was in leadership must be called Stalinism. When I first read Sakharov's book on the Testament of Lenin years ago, what struck me was how careful, even meticulous, Sakharov is as a reader of the evidence in identifying, studying, and drawing conclusions from the primary sources. That is what led him to his conclusion about the so-called testament, the conclusion that I outline in my book. There's an old book titled, The Historian is Detective. Okay. There's an old book titled The Historian as Detective. Here are some principles that echo the chief theses of this and similar works. Quote, what is the difference between a historian and a detective? Just as detectives must rely on firsthand accounts when investigating crimes, historians must rely on primary sources when studying history, end quote. Primary source evidence is the key. Marxists are materialists. Materialists decide questions of truth or falsehood on the basis of primary source evidence and solid objective reasoning, not on the opinions of authorities. The field of Soviet history of the Stalin period is very corrupt. In this field, liars like Timothy Snyder, Stephen Kotkin, Oleg Khlevnyuk, and many others get praise and rewards for lying about Soviet history of the Stalin period instead of dismissal from tenured positions, like Michael Belsiles got for lying about American history. When a prominent historian of American history, like Belsiles, was accused of drawing conclusions that did not fit the evidence or that were not supported by evidence, the prize his book had won was withdrawn, and he was forced to resign from his tenured position at Emory University. In 2010, Belsiles was an adjunct in history at Central Connecticut State University. He retired from teaching in 2017. That's what happened to him. Yet, when historians of the Soviet Union do the same thing, and in fact do it much more blatantly than Belsiles was accused of doing, they are rewarded and praised. No one scrutinizes their use of evidence. No one, that is, except me. I'd like to say a little more about primary source evidence. Here's the problem with all mainstream scholars in the field. Such experts like Kotkin, I have studied Kotkin the most closely, cite other secondary sources and only rarely cite primary sources. But only primary sources are evidence. Secondary sources, works by other scholars, are not evidence. Sometimes they do cite primary sources. When it is a question of some alleged crime or misdeed by Stalin, I have discovered the following. Either, one, the evidence cited is some archival reference that one can't check, or two, the evidence cited is some document that, when checked, does not support the anti-Stalin, anti-communist statements that the scholar has cited it for, or three, they cite no evidence at all. The difficult job here is to take the trouble to identify, locate, obtain, study, usually in Russian, and draw correct conclusions from the primary source evidence. Hardly anybody will do this, even other scholars. After all, why take all the time and make all the effort to do this if you already know the answer, meaning the only acceptable answer? For example, why study the evidence concerning the Katyn massacre when you already know the only acceptable answer? Or why study, not just read, but study, the transcripts of the three Moscow trials, plus all the related primary sources we now have from the former Soviet archives? This is a huge amount of work. 1,600 pages of transcripts, plus all the trouble of identifying, locating, obtaining, studying, and drawing correct conclusions from a great many additional primary sources related to them. Why do all this? Because you already know the only acceptable answer, which is that the defendants were framed. And if you did all this with Katyn, the Moscow trials, or other allegations of crimes of Stalin, and then on the basis of your study of all this evidence, you concluded that Stalin did not commit the crimes alleged, as I have done, then what? You could not get this published in acceptable journals. That's the anti-Stalin paradigm at work. It is forbidden, taboo, to conclude that Stalin did not commit some crime or other of which he has been accused. You will be ostracized. You may be called a Stalinist. That's what I am often called. That word means that your research should be ignored. Because you can't get your research published, you'll lose your job. Or if you have tenure, you won't get promoted. You won't be invited to conferences. You won't obtain research grants. In short, your professional life will be ruined because you have violated the anti-Stalin paradigm. So why go there? But sometimes a mainstream scholar like Kotkin surprises us. Kotkin's firm acceptance of Sakharov's conclusion that the testament of Lenin is a fraud has shocked and disturbed mainstream historians, including the Trotskyists. Writing in the New Yorker magazine of November 6, 2017, strongly anti-communist reviewer Keith Gessen put it this way, quote, "This was the one claim in the first volume that really rankled other historians. Some of them pointed out that the recent Russian originator of the testament forgery theory, on which work Kotkin relied, was an unapologetic Stalinist," unquote. Notice that Gessen does not even raise the question of evidence. For him and for the historians he refers to, it's enough to label Sakharov a Stalinist to dismiss his argument. Of course, this should work both ways, right? Mainstream historians are all unapologetic anti-communists, so why not dismiss their work too? But of course, they don't. Part of the reason that Belsiles was forced to resign and the prize for his book withdrawn was because he was accused of confirmation bias. Here's the Wikipedia definition of confirmation bias. Quote, confirmation bias is the tendency to search for, interpret, favor, and recall information in a way that confirms or supports one's prior beliefs or values. People display this bias when they select information that supports their views, ignoring contrary information, or when they interpret ambiguous evidence as supporting their existing attitudes. The effect is strongest for desired outcomes, for emotionally charged issues, and for deeply entrenched beliefs, end quote. When you hear someone accused of cherry-picking evidence, they are usually being accused of confirmation bias. I am also often accused of confirmation bias. That's the risk you take in this anti-communist world of deciding historical truth not according to what the authorities say you are supposed to find, but according to the evidence. I am called a Stalinist, just as Gessen calls Sakharov a Stalinist. That's the way things are in this corrupt field of study. A word about objectivity. In my book, New Evidence of Trotsky's Conspiracy, I wrote, quote, objectivity is the sine qua non of discovering the truth. But how can we learn the truth? How can we avoid being blinded by our own biases and preconceived ideas? It is the basic tenet of materialism that one's conclusions about reality, including historical reality, must be firmly based on evidence. This is the only way to discover the truth in history. The primary source evidence must be identified, located, collected, studied, and conclusions drawn from it that are based on the evidence alone, not on preconceived ideas, biases, or prejudices, and without faults in logic and reasoning. The materialist researcher must work hard to be thoroughly objective. She must be aware and suspicious of her own biases and preconceived ideas. Everyone possesses biases, prejudices, and preconceived ideas. So the materialist researcher must adopt a method that is closely similar to that used in the hard sciences like physics or chemistry. The objective historian must be self-aware. It is her own preconceived ideas and biases, not those of anyone else, which are most likely to mislead her and to poison her research. She must take special pains to look with increased suspicion at any evidence or argument that tends to confirm her own preconceived ideas. This is a threat of confirmation bias. She must also force herself to look with an additional dose of sympathy and interest at any evidence or arguments that tend to disconfirm her own preconceived biases. This is the only way to operationalize, to put into practical use, the ideal of objectivity. If a researcher fails to be objective, she will never discover the truth or even recognize it if she sees it. End quote. Objectivity is essential to discovering the truth. Yet almost no historians of the Soviet Union make any serious attempt to be objective. In fact, it is taboo to be objective. Why? Because there is no evidence that, for example, Stalin committed the crimes that are imputed to him. No evidence, but you can't say that. That is the anti-Stalin paradigm that I have written about. So objectivity goes out the window, and with it, any chance at all of discovering the truth. Lastly, in my classes, I always ask my students, quote, what is the most radical word in the English language in your opinion? Some say socialism, others say communism. I answer, these are good radical words, but I know one word that is more radical still, and that word is evidence. Demand evidence always and about everything, and before long, you will not only be called a communist, but a Stalinist. Thank you for listening.
Thank you. Thank you. Well, before opening the floors to questions and comments, there are a couple of items we're going to take care of. First of all, announcements on future meetings. I'll turn over to Gene Rohl. Would you want to tell us about future meetings?
That is exactly what I want to do, even though you can't see me. I'm
Now you can turn on your video, Gene.
Well, that's okay. People know I'm good looking, so we don't have to belabor the topic. Okay, next week, August 7th, we have an excellent program, which will also be a hybrid session. We, the Elites, Why the U.S. Constitution Serves the Few. And that will look more closely at what we all know about the way our society goes. And our speaker will be Robert Orvez, who is a senior lecturer in political science at San Jose State University in California. excuse me. Following that, we have on August 14, the Mexico Solidarity Project, CINITA, and the continuing importance of international working class solidarity. And that will be our comrade, Ann Lewis, who will is not flying into Oakland. She'll be joining us from, I believe, Austin, Texas. And so we have some other excellent programs. And the other thing I want to mention is I seem to be the go-to person. When people can't log on, they ask me for information. Sometimes I'm able to deal with that. But I also want to say that if you are interested in receiving our once a week reminders that include the login information, go to our website, icssmarks.org, and you'll see a sign-up form. Please fill that out, and then you'll start receiving our notices. And thank you.
Thank you, Gene. I want to say a word about our finances. This is the first time we've had a hybrid meeting at the Niebuhr Proctor Marxist Library in Oakland, and any live meeting. And I want to thank the staff of the library for preparing the space so well. But it's going to cost them and us continuing money to have our meetings here. So I want to urge you to make a contribution. On our website, there is a donate button, icssmarks.org. There is a donate button if you're not present in the hall. And if you're here, you can donate cash. So be generous, and we're trying to make these meetings as technologically efficient as possible. And your donations will help that. So now it's time to turn over the meeting to questions and comments. I will try to coordinate the Zoom hands up and the questions from the live audience here at the Niebuhr Proctor Marxist Library.
Would you say get together with the people that are on?
This is the best we can do right now.
You have
yes, we'll do that. Okay, any questions? And comments, I don't see any in the room. Any hands up? Yeah, first question.
If I may interject, Richard. Richard, if I may yes. interject, for yes, those who are in Zoom, we have actually two cameras in the meeting room today. You've been seeing Grover Furr as he was the speaker. But then if you go down on the participants, you will see Raj's name again, and that will show you the general view of the room, so you can see who is speaking as they approach the microphone and make their comments or questions. I just wanted to bring that out so that you are not lost in this hybrid meeting, and this is our first time too.
Yeah, we'll refine this whole process as we go along. Thank you for your patience. So the first person who has a question is Gene Rule on Zoom. Go ahead, Gene.
Okay, I'm here now. Okay, well, thank you so much, Grover. This was, as expected, interesting and provocative. And I also want to give a special thanks to our technical crew, Raj, Mehmet, and everyone else that was involved with this. I was a skeptic at first, but following Grover's advice, I waited for the evidence, and the evidence is that it works splendidly. So thank you so much for that. What I wanted to talk about a little bit is I enjoy these discussions, but I have to confess, I can't follow all of the evidence and accusations and counter accusations on what was going on within the inner sanctums of the Bolsheviks during this period. But my own support for the Soviet Union and for Stalin comes in what happened after 1929 and with the what's sometimes called the Second Soviet Revolution, which transformed Russian society, as we all know. And the key thing is that, you know, when Stalin died, the Soviet Union still existed. Nazi Germany did not. And that was a tremendous historical achievement for which all humanity is in Stalin's debt. And more than that, every Soviet worker was guaranteed a job, guaranteed health care, guaranteed education for her children, and guaranteed access to cultural achievements, books. Soviet citizens read more books, watched more plays, went to more films than their American counterparts, which, of course, not that great. But and it's also said that a Soviet woman could go to the Bolshoi ballet, the finest in the world, for like 25 kopecks, with or without her husband. So there were tremendous gains for humanity in the come out of the Stalin period. And I think we need to acknowledge that. And I think that gives added weight to what you're saying here. It's not just an academic discussion. There's real life consequences for that in terms of ongoing class struggles. So again, thank you, Grover, and keep fighting on.
Thank you.
Marilyn, go ahead and come to the microphone if you have a question.
Thank you very much, Grover, for your talk. It was really interesting. I have a question about Kotkin, who is, as I understand, is part of the anti-Stalinist paradigm in academia. So when he came out somewhere in his book, acknowledging that there or attesting that the Lenin Testament was a fraud, what kind of reaction did that evoke in the academic circles that are entrenched in the anti-Stalinist paradigm?
Well, thanks for the question. Is this on? Is the mic on?
Sure.
Okay. So, I touched on that a little bit, right? I quoted what Pipes had to say. And I quoted the, rather than go on with a long list of quotations, I quoted from the Wikipedia article, which cited a number of other historians who also rejected this, what Kotkin had to say, rejected the idea that the Lenin's testament was a fraud. And then I quoted from that review of Kotkin's book by Keith Gessen in the New Yorker magazine, where he says, well, why didn't Kotkin just ignore this guy because Sakharov, because he's a Stalinist, and instead of looking for the evidence? But the basic answer is this, and perhaps I didn't make it clear enough. I mentioned it, but perhaps I didn't stress it enough. So Sakharov is a professor of history at Moscow State University, and in the 90s, right after the end of the Soviet Union, he got access that you and I couldn't get. Okay, he got privileged access to much of the archive of Lenin's secretariat. I can't say that he got access to all of it, because I'm not sure about that. But he got access to a lot. And he was allowed to reproduce some of it, some crucial documents. He was allowed to photograph them. And I, rather than add to the expense of the book, I took those and put a commentary on it. The commentary is in the book and the images are online. And the link is in my book. So you could look at those documents that are in Sakharov's book and that he was able to photograph. Okay. But he got access to Lenin's, the documents in Lenin's secretariat for the last part of his life. And nobody else had bothered to do this. So that's one thing. Second thing is, starting in 1989 and going till August 1991, approximately, the Gorbachev regime had published a journal, which, you know, had a lot of other materials in it, but it had a historical section, and they started publishing a lot of documents from this early period, from the period around the time of Lenin's illness, okay, and then death, and shortly after that, struggles in the Bolshevik Party. These became published for the first time, and they were published in this journal. And so that's an important source of many documents as well. And Sakharov used those documents too. So he used primary source documents from Lenin's archive. He used the documents that had come out in the late Gorbachev period, a couple of other documents too. So he had at his disposal a lot of primary source documents that no one else has ever looked at. Nobody else had ever looked at them. And that, I think, is why all of these historians of the Soviet Union who are cited and who certainly Pipes others, dismiss what Sakharov has to say, because they said rightly, well, you know, Stalin and everybody in his day thought that these documents were genuine. And that's basically true. In fact, Stalin made a couple of remarks to Molotov that it looks like Stalin was not quite sure that some of them were genuine, but nevertheless, okay, for the most part, nobody questioned their accuracy and their genuineness. And this caused a problem, because in the 13th Party Congress, especially in 1923, a number of speakers at the Congress were very puzzled by the contents of these documents, which later became known as part of Lenin's testament. They weren't called that in 1923. And they attributed the problems in these documents to Lenin's illness. So I go into this in the book. Sakharov also says that. He says, well, you know, either in the case of some of these documents, either they were dictated by Lenin, but Lenin's judgment, Lenin's mind was affected by his illness, which would mean that they really weren't of any particular political use, or their fabrications. So, you know, there's much more detail in my book to the discussion of these documents from Sakharov had access to, that no one else had previously had access to, and evidently nobody else has bothered to have access to go and check them out since. None of these historians whom I cite, including Pipes, of course, even referred to this fact. They just said, oh, well, you know, the rest of these historians all say that Lenin's testament is genuine, and it's only really Kotkin and Sakharov who say they weren't. So, you know, the weight is on the side of the people who say they're not genuine. But the real issue is that Sakharov had access to documents that the rest of these people had never seen, had never looked at. And that's what is crucial about his book. It's not just Sakharov's book is not a reconsideration of documents that have been long known. Okay, there's that. But it's a reconsideration of documents that have been long known, in the light of many archival documents from Lenin's secretariat, which have not been known, okay, which he was the first to study, or perhaps the first to publish about. Probably the Khrushchevites saw them in some sense way back when. But that's what's new and striking about Sakharov's book, is he discovered the problems with many of these documents. He discovered the problems with the secretary's journal, for example, right? He discovered the problems, and he uncovered the problem of Krupskaya's deliberate lying, saying that there's some sort of quarrel with Stalin had happened on December the 22nd, 1922, when all of the other accounts of it say it happened 6 weeks later. And that's as you read the book, you'll see that's a crucial issue. And of course, there are some other very detailed issues, problems with some of these documents that I go into in the book. Sakharov goes into, I go into them in the book. Then that's because it's all in Russian. It's not really possible to discuss them very well in English, but I just at least in an oral presentation, but I discuss them in the book. So Sakharov had access to all kinds of documents that none of these other historians, not only did they not have access to them, it would be one thing if these other historians had said, if Pipes had said, well, you know, I didn't have access to these documents. So therefore, you know, I'm going to go with the mainstream story. They don't even acknowledge, they may not even know, Sakharov probably didn't even read the footnotes in Kotkin's book, 900 page book.
Did Kotkin attempt to defend his position on this issue?
I haven't seen that. He's given a number of talks. He's not asked about that in these talks. The talks he gives are basically sponsored by high-level academic or political organizations like the Hoover Institution and the Council on Foreign Relations, stuff like this. And they want to hear how the greatest expert in the world on Stalin, you know, what he's got to say about Stalin. That's what they want to hear. And they want to hear, you know, what made Stalin take Stalin the monster? What made Stalin the monster a monster? That's the kind of thing that they really want to hear. So no, he doesn't really go into this. Nobody's really talked to him about that. I think as I pointed out in my talk, in quoting Pipes and then this guy Keith Gessen, they wish he hadn't done it. Okay. They wish that Kotkin is such a towering figure in this field that it's not possible to really acknowledge where his views are coming from and then just dismiss them. I mean, if I just said it, you know, or Sakharov, whom nobody's heard of outside of Russia, if he said it, then you could just ignore it, right? But Kotkin is such a major figure that that it puzzled and bothered all of these people that he would do it. Not that he would discover it, but that he should have kept quiet about it, you know? Why throw away a good weapon against Stalin, right? I mean, that seems to be, in essence, their complaint. You know, why did he do this? It's a great book, except for this, you know? And that's part of the anti-Stalin paradigm. You're not supposed to say that Stalin did not do something bad if he did it. If the evidence says he didn't do it, you're not supposed to say that. Anyway.
Okay, now I'll go on to the next. One thing I want to ask you, Grover, is to hold up your book for the camera so that we can...
Sure.
Over here.
Oh, here we go.
Great.
Okay.
Okay. And you take your fingers away from the tie. Okay. Great. Thank you.
Okay, good.
Great.
I have a flyer here. I guess I should say, you can download a copy of the flyer or the page that contains the covers and the short description of all my books at the tiny URL. That's a tinyurl.com/14BKS, FourteenBKS, tinyurl.com/FourteenBKS, 14 books. And you go there and you can see a copy of all of my books and prices and how to order them. Okay.
Great. Go. So we have on the list Norma, Nina, Wax, Kit, and Janet. Go ahead, Norma. Go up to the microphone, please.
When I read what you were going to be talking about, I was totally thrilled to have that. Well, I was tremendously pleased to have that reputation of that content, which you do a lot of, and I'm always glad. The evidence is in, on a terrible, terrible basis. The Russian political action, military action against Ukraine is the evidence that the Soviet Union, Russia, I call it the US hegemonic attack against Russia has been going on for 110 years. And this is just evidence of everything that we all point out. It is not this whole thing of people running to support the Ukraine, which is shown over and over again to be overcome. If people had read history of the Second World War and before that, they'd know what a terrible, terrible place the border countries were that Russia insisted on populating with Russian control, the Soviet control, because they were so terrible. My uncle told me that Stalin pulled the Jews back from the front line when Hitler was invading.
Thank you. Next one is Nina Wax, please. Go ahead, Nina.
Hi. I guess in that vein, I wanted to get Grover's point of view on the invasion of Ukraine by Russia, and that's it. Okay.
Well, with all due respect, Nina, I really don't want to get into that here. This is a talk about about my new book, about the evidence concerning Lenin's testament. To raise the issue, I mean, that's an issue worthy of debate and discussion, but this isn't really the time and place for it. On a private basis, I'll be glad to tell you what I think, but I don't want to sidetrack the discussion this issue.
Fine. Could I get some private way? Could you send me your email or something like that?
Yeah, sure. You go to my webpage and you can find that just by going to Google and typing Grover Furr homepage, and it'll come right up, and my email address is there. I could also give it to you right now. It's furrg at mail.montclair.edu. But you can also get it just by Googling Grover Furr homepage. It'll come right up. Certainly, I'd be glad to do that. Thank you.
Thank you.
Next up is on Zoom, Kit, please. Unmute yourself, Kit.
I think you can unmute him, can't you? Whoever's
We'll next go on to Janet Coburn, and we'll come back to Kit.
Coburn. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Thank you. Thank you for this presentation. I'm not a scholar, nor have I researched any of what you've presented. I thought I heard you say that Stalin wasn't responsible for the millions of deaths in the Soviet Union that he is accused of. If that is the case, then who was, or did these deaths not occur?
Well, that's a very broad question. I suggest I can't give anything but the sketchiest response, since there are so many allegations against Stalin out there. I suggested at the beginning of my talk that for a general point like that, you may want to consult my book, Stalin Waiting for the Truth, which is an analysis of volume 2 of Stephen Kotkin's biography of Stalin. And that's where Kotkin really lets out all the stops and pours out all of the falsifications and lies about, you know, about Stalin and his mass murders and the deaths and all that kind of stuff. And I go through those point by point with evidence in that book. I spoke about that book, I don't know, a couple of years ago here, I guess it was. But it's one of my books. And I think that for people who are not, you know, sort of more closely engaged in Soviet history of this period, that's the first one to turn to, because it kind of covers a lot of territory, including the allegations that you yourself have mentioned. I should say one more thing, just to throw it in there. Up to this point, I've really published on, except for Khrushchev Lied, which does deal with the issue, with some things that occurred after World War II. But except for that, I've really dealt with the 1920s and 30s, because that's when the most crimes of Stalin are alleged to have occurred. But there's some stuff after World War II as well. There is an allegation out there, probably few, if any of you have heard of it, that Stalin had a Jewish theater producer named Solomon Michoels murdered in 1948. And this is accepted as a fait accompli. You know, he did it. We've got the evidence. It's nobody questions it. It's a complete fabrication. And my colleague in Moscow, Vladimir, and I are preparing a book on this subject. And it's really shocking, if you're still capable of being shocked by anti-communist lies. It's really shocking how transparent the fabrication of this event, that Stalin somehow murdered this guy. It's shocking how transparent it is. So, you know, I've done a little bit of work on the post-World War II period, but that book, Stalin Waiting for the Truth, will cover more than just the best known alleged crimes of Stalin. And I refer you to that.
Well, but may I, if I may?
Go ahead.
If Stalin didn't do that, then who did?
Well, there weren't any. Okay, there was a famine. Stalin didn't, in that 32-33, Stalin didn't cause it. He is said to have caused it. This is what the Ukrainian nationalists call the Holodomor. He didn't cause it, quite the opposite. The Soviet government helped to alleviate it. In 37-38, there were certainly some mass murders. They were carried out by Nikolai Yezhov, who was the head of the NKVD. I wrote a book about that. It's called Yezhov versus Stalin. It's one of the books that I list on my list. I gave a talk about it maybe 4 or 5 years ago here. That gives the evidence. Those are the major, when people talk about mass murders by Stalin, those are the major, the two major things they're talking about. There's also the issue of people dying in the labor camps in the Gulag. And the issue there is they basically died, the vast majority of people who died in the labor camps, so-called Gulag, died in 32-33, when a lot of people in the Soviet Union were dying because of the famine, and during the 42 and 43, during the war. And there's been some really good research published pointing out that the Soviet Union simply did not have enough food to feed the population in 41, 42, 43, and a good part of 1944. And workers, for example, and these are not people in prison, but just simply workers working in factories, building armaments and so forth, workers were literally dying of starvation on the factory floor. There was simply not enough food to feed the whole population. And there's some good quotations by anti-communist scholars pointing that out, that, you know, that the Soviets just couldn't feed anybody. And in one of them, Donald Filzer, who's an anti-communist, of course, but an expert on Soviet working class, written many books on the Soviet working class, now he's retired, wrote that no matter what the government was, it could have been capitalist, it could have been Trotskyist, it could have been any kind of government, they still would have faced the same problem, that there was not enough food to adequately feed the population. There would have been starvation no matter what. So those are the three areas where massive deaths are attributed to Stalin. Okay, if you want more detail, I refer you to that book of mine.
Okay. Thank you.
Sure. Kit, are you there? Yes, go ahead.
Yes. Okay. Thank you. And thank you, Grover, for coming back again to the East Bay and for your research. I really like that cover of your book. My question is, what's the argument between Krupskaya and Stalin that caused this rift and had her siding with Trotsky?
Yeah, well, you know, people have political ideas. Okay. It's not like Krupskaya said, actually, Trotsky did not like Krupskaya. He says some nasty things about her after his exile in the 1930s, but that seems to be connected with the fact that she didn't support him any longer. Okay, Lenin and Krupskaya lived in exile from the 1890s until the Russian Revolution. You're probably aware of that. Trotsky also lived in exile he had all kinds of political disagreements, of course, very sharp political disagreements with Lenin, but these emigres also kind of hobnobbed together, and to some extent, and Krupskaya got to know Trotsky's wife, Natalia Sedova, pretty well. So, you know, that may have had something to do with it. My guess is it probably did. And then I think it's legitimate for people in a communist party to have disagreements. And for some time, there didn't seem to be any problem different Bolsheviks, especially the high-ranking Bolsheviks, the influential people on the Central Committee and so forth, you know, had political disagreements and debated them out. So that Trotsky's opposition in itself, the fact that he had some different ideas, was not considered to be a problem for some time until he began to form a faction. But the mere fact of having disagreements, let's say with Lenin or with anybody, it's not in and of itself a problem. The problem that Lenin had with Trotsky and that others also had with him was that he's just very hard to get along with. And Trotsky had a long history during this pre-revolutionary period of being very, very abusive against Lenin. Okay, I mean, it wasn't just a question of, hey, you know, you have your opinion, I have my opinion, now let's go out and get a cup of coffee. They had very pointed polemics, and Trotsky called Lenin very harsh names. And the feeling was mutual. So there's a lot of bad feeling, if you want to call it there, behind the Lenin-Trotsky relationship. Stalin really did not. He wasn't involved in that. Stalin was not in exile. He was in Russia. And, you know, either in prison or when he wasn't in prison, he was organizing and leading various kinds of struggles in the working class, mainly in the Caucasus. But ultimately, who knows why Krupskaya sided with Trotsky for a couple of years and entered into the first couple of groups known as opposition groups. She dropped out of it around 1926 or so, but you know, she had her ideas and she expressed them in that fashion. More than that, you can't really say. She did, however, after 1926, she really stopped. She dropped out of the organized opposition and remained in the Central Committee and remained a supporter of the Central Committee for the duration, for the rest of her life until she died in 1939.
Okay. Next is Richard Wright. Go ahead, Richard, unmute yourself.
You might regret that.
Okay, go ahead.
I had a couple of questions regarding the historiography.
Yep.
That you laid out.
Yep.
The first one is the easiest one of the two questions is if Sakharov is the only person that had access to all these archives, then doesn't that challenge your your thesis of arriving at the objective truth if nobody else can get a hold of those archives or if nobody else examines those. The other question I had is...
Can we start with that one?
Sure. Yeah, go ahead.
I didn't say nobody else had access to them. I said nobody else was bothered to do it. However, there are a number of Russian historians who have written about... on the same subjects and have consulted the same documents. And I quoted in translation in my talk from the Russian Wikipedia page on Lenin's testament. It names four Russian historians who question Lenin's authorship of the so-called testament. That information is not in the English language Wikipedia page.
And as I might point out, the CIA is very active in manipulating Wikipedia.
Right.
You got to take that Wikipedia with a grain of salt. The other question, okay, so I'm still not convinced. I think you still need to get access to the source material in order to quote arrive at the truth, if you will.
Sure.
The other question I had, though, is a little bit more fundamental, I guess. At some point, you made a comment regarding historic materialism, and it implied that people that are doing research, and I would include journalists because they seem to exhibit this a whole lot more, but that you implied that you can step outside of your material existence and independent of the milieu and what you were brought up in. And I don't think that's really the case. I find it very hard to believe that there's anybody out there these days that would adhere to that thesis. I think that there's much more much more acknowledgement of bias, and I don't mind acknowledgement of bias. Much more acknowledgement of bias and an investigation of these materials within the constraints of that bias. So this independent objective seems to be a sleight of hand, you know. I'll drop it there. Thank you.
Well, I agree, but I think basically I disagree. Objectivity is a limiting concept. Okay, you can never be completely, totally objective, but you can strive to be as objective as possible. And that is the case in the hard sciences, and that is also the case in history. Now, if you want to... Okay, that's an important issue. So I agree with you that objectivity, that pure 100% objectivity is unobtainable, but I never suggested it was. I think you can and must try to compensate for your own bias. And I spelled out in the last part of my talk, I wrote a quotation where I briefly gave some instructions on how to do that. It is very dangerous to say that objectivity is impossible and you have to work within your own bias. I mean, you leave a door open to the Nazis. I mean, they had certain biases. They think the Jews were responsible for all the crimes in the world. And if they worked within their own bias, then, you know, they would go ahead and do what they did. And that's basically what they did. So the concept, the idea that you should not strive for objectivity as much as possible is a very dangerous concept, and really goes against not only modern scientific history, but really, really contradicts the whole evolution of human progress since at least the 18th century or so, you know, the Age of Enlightenment. You really have to figure out ways of becoming as objective as you possibly can be. And as for the business of primary sources, sure, I include reproductions of the photographs of some of these documents that Sakharov was allowed to reproduce in his book. And a number of these have been published too. Usually when people question objectivity, it's in defense of their own preconceived ideas. That's my experience. And I would caution that you to think about that and ask yourself whether that may not be happening to you as well.
Could I add a quick follow-up on that?
Sure.
If you don't mind. I mean, very often the social sciences are compared to the physical sciences as one being very objective and the other one being non-objective. I would submit that in point of fact, roughly since the World War II, the physical sciences have been much more open to interference, lack of objectivity. And you know, like Schrodinger's cat, for example, that the outcome is very much outcome is in some sense dependent on who's doing the observing, which leads to once again that even the physical sciences
mm-hmm.
are dependent on observation.
Of course. Well, it's been my experience, just briefly, and in conclusion, it's been my experience that. The question of objectivity is disturbing to people who have strongly preconceived biases that they would prefer not to question.
Okay, next question is from Raj. And before we go to that, I should remind people there is some pastry in the, we don't have coffee, I don't think today, but we do have some pastry okay. in the back, and hopefully we'll have coffee next time. So
okay.
Go ahead, Raj.
Okay, Grover, yeah, I haven't finished reading this book. I'm about halfway through.
Sure.
But you know, it's clear that Krupskaya had, you know, is involved in fabrication yeah. of this thing. And we also know that Krupskaya was allied with the so-called left opposition.
Mm-hmm.
And she switched in 1926
mm-hmm.
over.
Mm-hmm.
And the left opposition was, of course, Trotsky basically in the lead, but sometimes he hid behind Zinoviev and Kamenev. But Trotsky was the main, and there was this attraction to liberalism that I think the left oppositionists and all that had this attraction towards it. Somehow liberal ideas come in now that we have a revolution, which obviously the state could not afford and had to be very firm. So how can you talk a little bit about what motivated Krupskaya to join? Obviously, she's prejudiced against, I mean, there's something going on between her and Stalin. Can you share your thoughts from your research why Krupskaya would betray Lenin, Lenin's lifelong companion,
mm-hmm.
to be siding with a guy like Trotsky, which later on Krupskaya in the biography of Lenin said, well, comrade, Trotsky can never be accused of understanding Marxism sufficiently, you know? So he didn't know. So give us a little bit of your thinking on it. Thank you.
Well, we don't have any good biographies of Krupskaya, and certainly nothing that takes into account, you know, the fabrication of her role in the fabrication of this phony testament of Lenin. As Jean posted the other day on, or sent an email around, in 1925, Trotsky published an article in Bolshevik, which was the theoretical journal of the Communist Party, saying that there was no testament of Lenin. And in the same issue, Krupskaya published an article saying there was no such thing as the Testament of Lenin. But they both went back on that, you know, when it later on, they both continued to talk about the Testament of Lenin. So yeah, there's a lot going on back there. We don't know why Krupskaya. I mean, she obviously considered herself not to be just an adjunct to Lenin, right? But a political figure in her own right, which is the way it should be, right? I mean, she's not just, you know, Lenin's wife, but a Bolshevik in her own right. So she had her own ideas. And it was interesting that when Lenin became very ill, that her own ideas started to come out. You know, I suspect influence from other oppositionists, Trotsky, but there's certainly perhaps others too. See, mainly those who had been in exile with Lenin, with her and Lenin. I mean, if you take a look at the leaders of the opposition in the 1920s, not only Trotsky, but Bukharin and Zinoviev and Kamenev, they had all been living in exile. We saw a lot of each other. You know, Lenin played chess with all these people. They were all hanging out with each other. The wives hung out with each other too. They all had this kind of long personal history, which to some extent overrode or certainly had an influence on their political opposition to each other. However, Lenin was very firm. I think we've read Lenin's work. You'll see what I mean by very firm, right? Lenin would go to bat for the nth degree for his particular political views. The same kind of thing was true of Trotsky. I mean, you put those two guys together and your sparks are going to fly, okay? And that's what happened, right? Stalin, of course, had his own ideas and he was recognized as a major thinker and so forth and so on. But he always viewed himself as a student of Lenin, okay? He saw himself as a student of Lenin. There were people who saw themselves as followers of Trotsky. Trotsky was a charismatic person. And there were people who followed him and who thought that, you know, he was the person whose political analysis should be followed, was better than anybody else's, particularly after Lenin was no longer politically active, right? And Stalin, you know, Trotsky said bad things about Stalin, he's stupid and all this kind of stuff. Well, he wasn't, and nobody else thought he was, but Stalin always said, not only in the 20s, but throughout the rest of his life, he said, I am just a student of Lenin. Okay, don't talk about Stalinism, Stalin the great leader. He hated that. I document that in my first book, Khrushchev Lied. Don't talk about that. Talk about being a student of Lenin. That's what you should aim at being. Trotsky was not like that. Okay, Trotsky thought of himself as second only to Lenin as a great political figure. So as I said, that to some extent, personalities played a role. Okay, I don't want to reduce this to personalities as though nobody, you know, it was only a popularity contest or a contest in how to move people through argument. But it was a big aspect of personality. Personalities played a role. Trotsky was a very difficult person. And, you know, you could claim that in certain circumstances, certainly when it came to political issues, Lenin could be unmovable too.
Okay, Roger would like
just to a quick follow-up. Take a moment. So Krupskaya, it seems to me like Zinoviev and Kamenev mm-hmm. are influenced by Trotsky's ideas, which are very kind of liberating. Okay, well, we got, you know, workers are free now. You can build this on voluntary basis. You know, you don't have to have this powerful state mm-hmm. and this discipline that, of course, mm-hmm. Lenin was very strong on it. In fact, Lenin said, he often criticized Stalin, according to Molotov, what are you running, a milk and toast dictatorship or workers, you know, proletarian dictatorship? He was very strict, Lenin was. Stalin was actually softer initially. Mm-hmm. he was pushed into finally with all this intrigue around. Mm. But Krupskaya, it seems to me, I mean, I want you to address that. Was Krupskaya had attraction to this sort of thing from anything that you pick up about the ideas of Trotsky, political ideas, not so that she could vary from Lenin? I mean, is there any thing that's...
We don't think Krupskaya varied, at least as far as I'm aware. As I said, there really aren't any good biographies of Krupskaya because they're all either adulatory and edited, you know, to follow the line of the party, particularly since Khrushchev. So there really, in certain some sense, aren't any really good biographies of Krupskaya. But as far as we know, well, in the book and in my book and Sakharov, I think a little bit less explicitly, suggests that something happened in December 1922 that made Krupskaya decide that she was going to start to participate in the falsification of certain certain writings by Lenin. And whether she was convinced by Trotsky or whether she decided on her own, there were major political, you know, I don't want to reduce this personalities. I really don't think that's helpful. There were big political questions at this time. One of them was the formation of the Soviet Union. Okay. One of them was, you know, what do we do now? They ended up deciding, because Lenin had suggested it, the new economic policy, but you know, now that the Civil War is over, what do we do? How do we construct socialism? You know, the country is basically devastated. What do we do? That's a serious question, you know. No obvious answer. Can't look it up in Marx. Nothing there. Another is this question of the party's leadership tearing itself apart through contending oppositional groups. So in 1921, and this was when Lenin was still active, of course, in the 10th Party Congress, that there's a resolution passed against factionalism. Well, there had never been anything like that before. There had always been sort of these factions, but now Lenin insisted that this resolution be passed, and it was passed against factionalism, which means if you form a faction, you can come under party discipline, right? And so I'm sure that many people decided they weren't going to join factions anymore, but many people others that just drove the factions underground, it just drove the factions into clandestinity, okay? So that in some sense, the prohibition against factionalism didn't work. And then when the factionals became apparent, then you have the question of what are we going to do with these people? How are we going to discipline them, right? So that, perhaps made the instead of settling the political disagreements, in some sense it made them sharper and also drove some of this stuff underground. So this was a very difficult period, fraught with serious questions. And you know, I don't think that we can say that it's mainly an issue of personality. I mean, everybody has their personalities. It turns out that Trotsky was forming a faction very early on. You can say, well, you know, he was dishonest. Okay. He accused Stalin of forming a faction. Okay. That whole attempt to get rid of factionalism didn't really work. But specifically why Krupskaya decided to do what she did, I think the best thing to do at this point is to say she saw herself as an independent political thinker and actor, not as an adjunct of Lenin. And she wanted to be treated that way. And she had ideas that she was sure that Lenin wouldn't agree with. And she went ahead and tried to implement some of those ideas, which didn't really become, because that's in contradiction perhaps to being Lenin's main caretaker when he was very sick. So once Lenin's illness and incapacity became beyond a certain point, she became her own political, independent political judgment and activity, I think became more obvious. That's all. She was no Lenin, of course. If you've read that Molotov Remembers, you refer to that, you know, that Molotov talks about that. You know, she was not a great, in his view, she was not a great political thinker, but she was in a powerful position.
Okay. Any more questions?
I was going to make this comment.
Okay. Go ahead, Norma.
Can't we bring the rest of the people into this meeting from the Zoom?
Whoa.
Stop it. Stop it. Smack it.
But go ahead.
Go ahead and talk over there.
Yeah.
Oh, no. I don't think there's anything we can do. On the microphone. Yeah, put it right up by your mouth.
Well, it doesn't make any difference if it's right up. Maybe it does.
We can't hear you, Norma. We can't hear you. That's very good.
I know.
Loud and clear. Thank you.
My sister-in-law could hear me over an airplane taking off at the airport. The thing about Trotsky, I began to realize Trotsky is kind of exemplary of what people like Clinton and Obama and John F. Kennedy, they put together material, orally at least, that the people will attach themselves to, that will bring the people in without being honest. They just, oh, I think the people would like to hear this. And they say those things, you know, we're going to fix welfare, for example, and the other things that they do. So it helps, I think, to understand what Trotsky was about, it seems to me, was positioning himself to have something to say that was really appealing and wonderful. And it was distortions and manipulations of people's thinking so that they would go along with what he was doing. And this goes along with the land of the free. Okay. We live this myth that America, United States, is the land of the free. Sure. And it is created by these distortive language presentations of the people who get the microphone, get elected, and all these other.
Well, and I, years ago, I don't know, 2012 or something, maybe 10 years ago, I decided I'd really have to look into Trotsky. And the reason I thought so is because Khrushchev, in his secret speech, attributed a number of crimes to Stalin falsely, as I discovered, that Trotsky had also attributed to Stalin, right? To some extent, it seems that Khrushchev may have even copied some of these things from Trotsky. So I decided, well, you know, I'm going to have to investigate Trotsky. And so what I decided to do was to start out with his published works. Okay, start out with his published works, and particularly his published works from, like, say, 1927 on. And they're all in English, and they're all available, and they're all online, or at least they used to be, and I downloaded them, and just study what he had to say. And what I discovered, and it wasn't that I thought I was going to, I didn't know what I was going to find, but what I discovered was a little surprising to me, was that Trotsky was a very opportunistic liar. If you compared the things that he said for over time, you could see that he would falsify things. He would say one thing one time, and then a year later he'd say something completely different. A year later he'd say something else different. And then when you got to the mid 30s, he started quoting more frequently from accounts of stuff that was going on in the Soviet Union. He would quote either from Izvestia or Pravda, or he would quote from the French. He was living in France for some time, he would quote from the French Communist Party newspaper, L'Humanité, because they had reporters in the Soviet Union who were reporting back about the stuff that was going on in the Soviet Union, and he would quote from them. So I obtained copies of the articles and issues that he said in his writings that he was quoting from, or that he was summarizing. And I saw that he was summarizing them falsely. It just wasn't true that those articles said what he said they said. And that was pretty amazing, actually. And what was amazing about it is not that he told a lie or two. I guess everybody lies at some point in their life, you know, but that he just did this repeatedly. And of course, every time you do something like that, and this is publicly available stuff, you take the risk that somebody could could do what I did. Just go back and check it and see. Let's see if he's quoting these articles right. Let's see if he said something different some time ago. Evidently, nobody did. Or if they did, I didn't find any evidence that they had published any of this. Evidently, nobody had actually done that. But it was, there it is. So I have this little book. I have a big fat book called Trotsky's Amalgams, but I divided that into three shorter books because people don't like to read 550-page books. So I have a little book called Trotsky's Lies. I think there might be a copy of it up here. And that's the first 12 chapters or so of the Trotsky's Amalgams. And that's just my chapters on Trotsky's writings in the 1930s, where you can show that he's lying and you don't need declassified Soviet documents to do it. You know, you can just compare either his writings to each other, or you can compare them to the stuff that he was said to be quoting from. And it's remarkable that he lied so much and that evidently nobody called him on it. So, I mean, that's, on the one hand, I can't really explain it. On the other hand, though, he was mainly writing for his followers, which is a fairly, I mean, he was writing to make money. He sold articles to the New York Times and other commercial newspapers, and he needed to make some money. Okay. But who was actually paying serious attention to what Trotsky was saying politically? His followers. And he was trying to build a movement. And he did build some sort of a movement here and there. And these people were not inclined to check what Trotsky said. They were just, you know, just looking for what he said. They were followers of Trotsky, so they kind of took it for granted that, you know, this is his analysis. Maybe somebody else did it, but they never published anything. So I think that it's, when you see that he lied so frequently and so brazenly in a certain sense, taking the chance of getting caught at it with material that is publicly available, then when it came to the material that was in the Trotsky archive at Harvard, or, you know, his own archive, or materials that we can now have access to from the former Soviet archives, it's less surprising that he's lying. Back in 1980, January 1980, the Trotsky archive at Harvard University, which Trotsky had sold to Harvard back in the 30s, became available to researchers. And right away, Pierre Brouet and a bunch of graduate students from France, Pierre Brouet was the foremost Trotskyist historian in the world at that time. He's long dead now, but he was very active at that time. He published a journal called Notebooks of Leon Trotsky Notebooks, Cahier Leon Trotsky. He discovered that Trotsky had lied seriously. And he actually published, he actually exposed the fact that Trotsky lied. It's amazing because, you know, normally you'd think that he would cover it up, but he didn't cover it up. He apologized for it. He said, oh, you know, Trotsky was right to lie. He was correct to lie. Oh, you know, what the hell is that? But he exposed it. And then, you know, you go back, and then Arch Getty, who is an American historian, who formerly at UCLA, now retired, went into the Trotsky archive. He discovered some more lies of Trotsky's right there in his own archive, you know, that had they been known in the 1930s, would have, I mean, the Dewey Commission could never have concluded that Trotsky was framed. That's why I have this little book called The Fraud of the Dewey Commission. Trotsky lied to those people. If he had told the truth to the Dewey Commission, they'd have never have found him not guilty, which is what they did. So, I mean, it's, so there's that, okay? I don't like to reduce things. I don't like to reduce political issues to personalities. But Trotsky had no compunction about lying whenever it seemed to suit his purposes. And sometimes, I say that in that book, sometimes I can't even see any purpose in his lying. What what gain in certain specific cases? What could he possibly have had to gain by telling this particular lie? I can't figure it out. But you know what? Then I concluded, you know, Dover, this is your problem. Your problem is you're an academic and you are looking for the truth and you think that it's terrible that people lie, you know, that this historical figure is lying. But ultimately Trotsky was right. It wasn't until I discovered these things. And that's what, 80 years after his death or something, not quite, but you know, 70 years after his death, 75 years after he died, that these lies were discovered. So they worked. You know, he wasn't thinking about what's going to happen 75 years after he's dead, right? He was thinking about what effect it's going to have now. And they worked. His followers believed them. And frankly, his followers still believe them. So Trotsky was right. he was correct. He was correct. He actually took very little risk, maybe no risk at all in lying, because nobody really checked up on it until I came.
Raj, go get some water. Or somebody get some water for
Robert, no, I'm okay.
Is this close enough?
Is that Sharon behind her?
Hi.
Is that Sharon?
Yes.
Hi, Sharon.
Hi. Thank you very much. I'm wondering if you could just comment on the following. Yeah. So I think that the importance of your work is very important. And it's not because we old timers need to rehash all this, although it's interesting to do that.
Yeah.
It's for the future.
Yeah.
It's for the next generation and the following generations of people who are thinking about how to build socialism and need to understand the mistakes of the 20th century and what happened in the 20th century. And so I'm wondering, I think a lot of those particular people that we're agreeing are so important are Chinese. So I'm wondering whether your work has been translated into Chinese or if there's any plan to do that. I think it would be extremely important.
Thank you. Khrushchev Lied was translated and published in Chinese 6 or 7 years ago. There's a wonderful gentleman, retired professor in Beijing, who is working on one of my other books. It seems to be taking a hell of a long time, and he's pretty old, so I don't know if that's going to actually. But it would be good. Yeah, but it would be good. But I have taken to China a few times they've invited me. I've taken some of the translations, of the French translations of some of my books, and all of the English versions of the books that were available up until the last time I was invited there. I've taken that and given it to people there. So, it's in the library and the Institute of Marxist Studies somewhere. But yeah, sure. And the other place, as Raj has pointed out to me, I think he's right, where there are a lot of communists is India. Raj pointed out to me years ago that probably leaving aside China and, you know, whatever you might think of, or Korea, whatever, Cuba, leaving aside China, probably 75% of all the people in the world who consider themselves communists are in India. So, and I've been much more fortunate there. I've had books, not all of them, of course, translated into 5 or 6 different Indian languages, and that continues. And the Indian people in India, you know, communists in India, some communists in India are very interested in that and have brought those books out. And Khrushchev Lied's out in, I think, six different Indian languages now. And most importantly, and Raj basically arranged for that, most importantly, perhaps in Hindi, which is the national language, which in some sense all people of education of a certain level read. Although outside of the Hindi speaking area, a lot of people read English as well as Hindi, and maybe even better than Hindi. But Khrushchev, you know, some of my books have been translated into at least 6 Indian languages, and that's proceeded much more rapidly than in China. So I'm very happy about that. That's very encouraging. You know, I'd like to get it in more of the European languages too, but you know, a lot of these, but they're not nearly as many people. I mean, there's a French publisher now who publishes just about everything I write and translates it into French and publishes it in French. And they've just finished translating this book, but it won't be published. You know, they do these things one at a time, so it won't be published for another year or two. But yeah, China and India would be very good.
Okay.
Your books have been published in Turkish, a lot of books.
Oh, yes, of course. Yes, quite a number in Turkish. Okay. Yes, I didn't mean to give a list. I'm sorry, Mehmet, I didn't mean to slight the Turkish.
No, that's okay. I just wanted
to. Yeah, there are a number of countries that have published translations of my book. A German edition of one of my Trotsky books just came out. There's a couple of them in Italian. I've got contracts, whatever that's worth. But you know, that may happen in Greece and Czechoslovakia, and so forth. And of course, a number of them have been published in Russian. So, you know, word's getting out there. And Spanish is very important, and I've had a lot of trouble with the Spanish, trying to get stuff in Spanish. And Portuguese apparently is out there. I don't have any copies, but I've been told that it's in Brazil and in Portugal. One or two of my books are available. I don't have any copies of them, but I'm told that that's the case. So, yeah, I mean, the word is getting out there. Yeah.
Well, thank you. We need to bring the formal part of our program to an end.
There is somebody with their hands up, some remarks,
Grover, or else we'll bring the.
I want to thank you all. First of all, I want to thank you all for attending. Those of you who are on Zoom, that's very important. And those of you who are here in person, it's wonderful to see you again. It's great to be back in the Nebelprotro Marxist Library for the first time in 28 months or so. I hope that you can continue to have these in person or perhaps in-person plus Zoom meetings. That's very meaningful to me. I feel honored to be invited back. I would ask you all to download the list of my books. I think I gave you the link. It's a tiny URL, tinyurl.com/14books, FourteenBks. And that'll lead you to the page where you can download the books. If you wish to, it would be great if you could try to get some of these books into libraries that you have any contact with so that they'll really be available. In other words, if I sell 100 books, but they're all sitting on private persons' bookshelves, they're in some sense, they're not widely available, right? They become widely available when they get into libraries. We can't hope to get them into the bookstores, but I would ask you to do that. And once again, thanks for coming. Thanks for your questions. The sharpest questions are always the most interesting, and I'm glad to receive them. Don't fail to email me if you have more questions. I'd be glad to hear from you, and I'll do my best to respond to your questions. And once again, all the best to you, to the library, to the ICSS. Continue your wonderful work. Thanks.
Thank you very much. We will continue the program non-recorded if people want to engage in. Institute for the Critical Study of Society at the Nebelprotro Marxist Library receives no corporate funding, nor do we have any paid staff. We rely on the support of working class folks that share our commitment to the socialist legacy of Karl Marx. We continue to need funds to meet necessary expenses. Since we can no longer pass the hat at our in-person forums, please send contributions to our treasurer, either online via PayPal or by check. The PayPal ID is ICSS Sunday, SUNDAY, @yahoo.com. And the name is Richard Fallenbaum. and checks may be made out to Richard Fallenbaum and sent to him at 1225 Nielsen Street, Berkeley, California, 94706. Fallenbaum is spelled F-A-L-L-E-N-B-A-U-M. To donate directly to the Marxist Library, send a check to the Nebro Proctor Marxist Library at 6501 Telegraph Avenue, Oakland, California, 94609, or directly or donate online at www.paypal.me/npml. For information, write to npml at marxistlibr.org. And the website is marxistlibr.org.